Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Womanly Art of Breastfeeding by Diane Wiessinger, Diana West, and Teresa Pitman. Narrated by Pam Ward. Welcome. Before there was The Womanly Art of Breastfeeding, there was what I've always thought of as the story of breastfeeding. That story wasn't written down. It was the breastfeeding wisdom passed down from one generation to the next, mother to mother. Unexpectedly, beginning in the first part of the 20th century in the most developed parts of the world, the transfer of the story practically ceased, but not entirely. The remembrance of the story of breastfeeding nourished the writing of the first edition of The Womanly Art, published in 1958, cradling it and sustaining its promise. What never disappeared was the instinctive desire held by many mothers who longed to breastfeed their babies, despite the highly touted advances of bottle feeding, only later correctly labeled artificial infant feeding. For many of these hopeful mothers, the desire to breastfeed was thwarted early on due to misinformation or the plain lack of information. I was one of those mothers with my Elizabeth, my first baby. Advised by the doctor that I didn't have enough milk, I began supplementing with formula. It was the beginning of the end of breastfeeding for us at 3 months, a regret I carry to this day. A move to Franklin Park, Illinois, brought our family in touch with Dr. Gregory White, who was alternately referred to as totally out of step with the times or a prophetic maverick. My husband Chuck and I were delighted to learn he believed in old-fashioned, natural childbirth and breastfeeding. Early in our parenting career, Chuck simply went along with my offbeat ideas, but later he became a strong advocate of them. With the birth of our second child, Timothy, in 1952, and with Dr. White's steady guidance, we were on the right track. A protege of Dr. Herbert Ratner, an early advocate of the wisdom of nature, Dr. White gave me the best mothering advice I ever received. A baby's wants are a baby's needs. Gone were the confusion and worries about spoiling my baby, holding him too much or too little, following the clock, or nursing on demand. It was wonderful, blessed freedom. Around the same time, I discovered other young mothers who were also breastfeeding their babies, an underground of anti-establishment mothering, picking their babies up rather than letting them cry, and taking them with them when going out. One of these mothers lived around the corner from me, Betty Wagner. Her family was somewhat older than mine. As we walked our babies on summer evenings, Betty shared her breastfeeding experience, little tips that made nursing the baby and caring for a growing family less stressful, more enjoyable. Various strands of the story were coming together for me, caring, like-minded women companions, a supportive family, knowledgeable medical professionals. In 1956, the most memorable instance of the revitalization of the story of breastfeeding came about when seven women in the Franklin Park area, all by then experienced breastfeeding mothers, chose the name La Leche League and committed themselves to reaching out to help other mothers who also longed to breastfeed their babies. The core group, hereafter known as the seven founders of La Leche League, consisted of Marianne Cahill, Edwina Frohlich, Marianne Kerwin, Viola Lennon, Marianne Thompson, Betty Wagner, and Mary White. Both Dr. White and Dr. Ratner remain lifelong champions of breastfeeding and La Leche League, which spread rapidly, like a smoldering fire newly reignited. And so the final element fell into place for the continuation of the story of breastfeeding. A forum and process were put in place for mothers to come together, observe a loving and natural way of mothering, exchange information, and find support and companionship. This new edition of The Womanly Art of Breastfeeding, the 8th, furthers this effort, opening new worlds of breastfeeding information, from pertinent findings from the scientific literature to the homey and highly prized experiences of ordinary mothers and babies. A totally new rewrite, it is a tribute to its three writers. Yet in the background, arrayed like a Greek chorus, stand the many mothers who have come before us. Dear listener, begin the story and discover the beauty and power of breastfeeding. Step into history. There's a place for you in what will always be your own highly personal experience and enduring memories, but also an act of great consequence to you, your child, and your family, to all of society, to the world. Thank you. Marianne Cahill, La Leche League International co-founder. Introduction. Welcome to the newest edition of The Womanly Art of Breastfeeding. This is a book for you, wherever you are in your mothering journey. It's a book about developing a breastfeeding relationship with your baby, with strategies that help combine breastfeeding with your already busy life, and ideas for meeting any challenges along the way. There's some science, for sure, but we hope to bring to life the art part, the fun part, the way you and your baby figure out your own dance and make this work for you. Does our title sound old-fashioned? That's because it's been around for more than half a century, dating back to 1956, when almost all TV shows were black and white, and many countries' breastfeeding rates were at an all-time low. The Womanly Art of Breastfeeding was the first book about breastfeeding for mothers that was written by mothers, seven of them, in fact. These mothers didn't start out to write a book. They were enjoying breastfeeding their babies. Many of them had bottle-fed earlier children and breastfed later children, and they had all figured out, as mothers always have, that breastfeeding is much easier when we talk about it with friends. So they began holding monthly get-togethers in their homes for other women interested in, breastfeeding. Because the very word was shocking in those days, they chose a code name, La Leche, spelled L-A-L-E-C-H-E, Spanish for the milk, league, after a shrine in St. Augustine, Florida, Nuestra Señora de la Leche y Buen Parto, Our Lady of the Milk and Good Birth. That first La Leche League group quickly became multiple groups. Questions from local mothers became questions from across the country. By 1958, to keep up with the flood, the women had written a simple overview of breastfeeding basics. They made copies, their children helped collate the pages, and the first Womanly Art of Breastfeeding, all 31 pages of it, was mailed from their homes. In 1963, just 5 years later, they wrote a longer version, found a company to print it, and ultimately sold over 1 million copies. And so it grew. Today, from Bolivia to Bulgaria, South Africa to Singapore, breastfeeding mothers get together at La Leche League, LLL, gatherings to celebrate, laugh, cry, and learn from one another. They may share some technical advice, but mostly they talk about their daily breastfeeding experiences, life with a new baby, how to get a reasonable night's sleep, what solids to offer a breastfeeding toddler, what to say to doubting relatives. It's that sharing of experiences, mother to mother, that has been the heart of every LLL gathering and every edition of The Womanly Art of Breastfeeding from 1958 through today. We hope this edition will be like a La Leche League meeting, just enough science to light your path and smooth any rough spots in the road, but mostly practical tips and stories from mothers who have been there. As you read it, we hope you'll think of yourself as being surrounded by all the pregnant women and mothers who are reading it at this same moment, as well as the mothers from the generations before you who have contributed to it. By breastfeeding your baby, you're joining a sisterhood of mothers that reaches back to our earliest ancestors and forward to future generations. What makes this book different from other breastfeeding books? What if you had to choose? You can either bottle feed your baby with scheduled feedings and little body contact, but with your milk in the bottle, or you can breastfeed your baby, responding to his cues, but only formula comes out of your breasts. Which would you choose? You'd be choosing between the product of human milk and the process of breastfeeding, and you couldn't have both. Some mothers would choose the milk, for all its protective and health-giving factors. Others would choose breastfeeding because they value the closeness and connection. They just couldn't imagine raising their child any other way. There's no right answer, but in today's world, many women would automatically choose the product over the process because human milk gets all the glory. Studies of human milk are straightforward. Relationships are hard to study. We have tons of research on the importance of a precious fluid that just happens to be delivered from your breast. But this book also celebrates the relationship, the heart of breastfeeding, not just the fluid. Breastfeeding is a connection as well as a food source, a baby's first human relationship, designed to gentle him into the world with far more than just immune factors and good nutrition. It's a way of mothering your baby, a relationship that develops feeding by feeding, building trust, closeness, knowledge of each other, and a deeply connected attachment that lasts long after weaning. Every language has its own word to describe the infant at his mother's breast. North American English has two, breastfeeding and nursing. Nursing in other English-speaking countries tends to mean cuddling or caring for a baby. Maybe nursing began to mean breastfeeding in North America because it allowed the speaker to avoid the word breast. But we like it because it doesn't imply that it's just a feeding method. So in addition to talking about breastfeeding, we'll deliberately be using the word nursing because to us it means a connection that's more than just the milk. What's different in this edition? This edition is for you, the 21st century mother. This new century has new attitudes, new expectations, new trends, and new babies built on a very, very old design. Today's babies have the same reflexes, the same instincts, the same needs that babies had thousands of years ago. We'll offer perspectives on how the age-old behaviors of babies affect breastfeeding today, what our babies need from us, and what we need from motherhood. And we'll help you find ways to adjust when your life and biology don't match. The world you're living in also has more varied family structures. So we use the word partner in this edition to mean the person who shares your home, your life, and the care of your baby, whether that's a husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, or significant other. Or you may have parents, friends, family members, or roommates whose presence is important to you and your child. You have access to an almost infinite amount of information about breastfeeding online, but there's plenty of misinformation out there as well, and it can be hard to know what to trust. So the concepts in this book are backed by the best practices in modern lactation science and solid research, with websites mentioned throughout the book in case you want to learn more. They're also backed by decades and decades, maybe millennia, of mother wisdom. Breastfeeding has always been something that women learn from one another, not from experts. So you'll read about other mothers' experiences throughout. Because our support networks are so vital to breastfeeding successfully, we've added a whole chapter just on this topic. There's also a lot of information on birth in this edition, because while you can find plenty of books about either birth or breastfeeding, there is a vital connection between the two that isn't usually discussed. This is even more important today, when most women have medical interventions, such as induced labor, epidurals, or C-sections, during labor and birth. These interventions can have unexpected effects on both babies and mothers who are trying to get their breastfeeding relationship underway. To help get things back on track, we've added a chapter just about latching to explain approaches that tap into your and your baby's built-in reflexes and instincts. We've added a section of chronological chapters with much more information about the practicalities of living with a breastfed baby at each stage of development, including the joys and journeys of breastfeeding a child beyond the first year. We've delved deeper into ways to get enough sleep, start solids, and wean. If you're going back to work, we've added an expanded chapter to help you continue breastfeeding successfully, minimize your and your baby's stress, and reconnect with each other after your time apart. We've added more information about ongoing challenges like exclusive pumping, preemies, multiples, milk supply issues, breastfeeding with a chronic illness, and babies with special needs. We've added a tech support chapter with to-the-point information on shorter-term problems such as engorgement, jaundice, breast infections, medications, and surgery. We have a chapter all about La Leche League, how we started, and what we're all about. Because sharing our stories is the way we women connect to one another most deeply, you'll find a story at the beginning of each chapter, written by a mother from the past or present, sharing her experience from across time and space. It's remarkable how much wisdom there is in the stories of mothers from many years ago. Although the world has changed, much about breastfeeding is timeless. This edition's authors. We are three La Leche League leaders, accredited LLL counselors. We've breastfed our own babies, 9 of them among the 3 of us, for a combined total of nearly 30 years. Yes, they've all weaned. Experiences that drew us to work with, write for, and speak about breastfeeding mothers and babies. For each of us, breastfeeding was a transformational experience, central to the way we learned to parent our children. It wasn't always perfect or easy. We've struggled through mastitis, plugged ducts, thrush, and sore nipples. We've had babies who came early and babies who came late, babies who wanted to nurse constantly, and babies who refused the breast altogether. We've had too much milk and not enough milk. We've worked in the home and outside. And when breastfeeding didn't work out, there was still a heart full of love and a parenting style that was as close to human biology as we could make it. Diana's interest in helping mothers grew out of low supply with her first baby and her desire to find solutions. Diane wandered into it when she realized she was beginning to give as much help as she got at LLL meetings. Teresa figured from the start that if her horses, cats, and dogs could give birth and feed their babies, she could too, and she became a leader to help others find their own paths. But there also have been hundreds of contributors to this book, new mothers, older mothers, and great-grandmothers, whose experiences have helped countless mothers over time. This is their book, and this is your book. We hope that this edition of The Womanly Art of Breastfeeding will help you settle comfortably into a breastfeeding style that fits you, your baby, and your corner of the world. We think that learning about other mothers and your own and your baby's natural tendencies will make finding your own style easier and more satisfying. As you'll hear at almost any La Leche League meeting anywhere in the world, take a look around, choose only what feels best for you and your family, and leave the rest behind. Whether you get ideas and information from our book, from research, or from talking to other mothers, you know yourself, your baby, and your family better than anyone else, just as mothers always have. We want to hear from you. Please visit the forums at LLLI.org and share your experiences. Tell other mothers how things are going for you and ask any questions that come up as you read this book. In every era, mothering skills have spread like the ripples of a pond, mother to mother to mother. Someone's ripple touches your life, you learn, and you send out ripples of your own. It's a method of sharing as old as humankind. And as soon as you share that first pregnancy hint with another woman, you've become one of the ripple makers. So keep in touch. Your ideas and experiences might be just what the next mother needs to hear. Part 1. New Beginnings. Chapter 1. Nesting. When I was 2, my mother came home from the hospital cradling 2 mysterious bundles wrapped in soft blue blankets. One was my new baby brother. She handed me the other. Underneath the folds of that soft blanket was a beautiful doll, which my mother explained would be my special baby. My father followed her with a red wooden rocking chair that he placed near my mother's rocking chair. I vividly recall watching my mother breastfeed my brother, and I followed her every move to be sure that I was feeding my own baby properly, even though my breasts looked nothing like hers. My mother and baby brother gazed at each other adoringly during the feeding. I looked down at my own doll, whose eyes closed when she lay on her back. I wanted that lifeless doll to be real. I told myself, I can't wait to grow up so I can feed my own baby. 25 years later, I gave birth to my first child. The day I came home, I sat in our wooden rocking chair, and as I held my son close and nursed him, he opened his eyes to gaze at me. At once, an overpowering recollection of that early childhood memory returned, and tears began to flow as I realized, this is what I've waited my whole life to do. Kathy, remembering 1981. Welcome to our La Leche League meeting in a book. At a real meeting, you'd see a mix of pregnant women, mothers with new babies, and moms with older babies or children. You'd hear questions from women at different stages of motherhood. Some of it would sound right to you. Some of it would answer questions you didn't know you had. And some of it you'd shrug and leave behind. We hope you'll do the same with this book. The cornerstone of La Leche League, LLL, meetings is addressing questions. While a book can never match sitting around with other mothers, we can address some of the typical questions at different stages and tell you what mothers often share from their experience, along with the research behind it all. This first chapter of our meeting in a book begins with the questions pregnant mothers often have about breastfeeding. Even if you've already had your baby, the answers to these questions should make you feel good about what you're doing and tell you more about why breastfeeding is such a great thing to do. The newborn baby has only three demands. They are warmth in the arms of his mother, food from her breasts, and security in the knowledge of her presence. Breastfeeding satisfies all three. Grantley Dick Reed, M.D., from Childbirth Without Fear, 1955. Is breastfeeding right for me? The closer you are to meeting your new baby, the more you're probably thinking about what comes after birth. You're nesting, gathering the things your baby will need, and making a place for him in your home. Those outfits are so cute. That changing table is precious. But while you're out shopping, your body is quietly preparing the real nest your baby will need, your breasts. They'll be all he really needs at first. His go-to place for warmth, security, comfort, love, and, yes, food. As cute as the outfits and decor are, what your baby will care most about is the way you and your body protect and nurture him. Breastfeeding is far more than just a way to feed your baby. It's the way you're naturally designed to begin your mothering experience. So why doesn't it always come naturally? Some of your friends may have told you all about their tough experiences. Maybe your mother couldn't breastfeed, and you wonder if you'll have trouble too. The great news is that we've learned a lot since your mother tried. We've learned more about understanding and respecting the instincts that you and your baby both have. We've learned that the fewer interventions you have during birth, the easier these instincts will be to tap into. And La Leche League is always there to help you work through any issues that come up. Maybe you want to breastfeed because you know it's best. Science keeps finding new ways breastfeeding helps babies reach their potential and protect their mother's health. Maybe you want to because it just feels right. Every mother finds for herself all the little ways that breastfeeding brings her close to her children. Whether the urge comes from your head or your heart, breastfeeding is right for you. And it's definitely right for your baby. How important is breastfeeding, really? Extremely. There's almost nothing you can do for your child in his whole life that will affect him both emotionally and physically as profoundly as breastfeeding. Breastfeeding is also important to our own bodies. We can't think of an aspect of your baby's health that isn't affected by breastfeeding. And it affects a surprising number of your own health issues as well. This would be a much longer book if we described all the ways that breastfeeding is valuable for you, your baby, and your family. But here are a few highlights. Your milk is your baby's normal food. There's no formula that comes even close to the milk your body creates. Your milk has every vitamin, mineral, and other nutritional element that your baby's body needs, including many that haven't been discovered or named yet. And it changes subtly through the meal, day, and year, to match subtle changes in his requirements. Living cells that are unique to your milk inhibit the growth of harmful bacteria and viruses in his still maturing system. And it's more than just living cells. For instance, interferon and interleukins are powerful anti-infectives. If you could buy them, they'd cost the moon. Your milk throws them in free of charge. A squirt of your milk can even treat eye infections and speed the healing of skin problems. Without his normal food, a baby is at higher risk of ear infections, intestinal upsets, and respiratory problems. Allergies and dental problems are more common. Vision, nerves, and intestines don't develop fully. Because of all these differences, and many others not listed here, a formula-fed baby has a different metabolism and a different development, and gains weight differently during his first year. His kidneys and liver work harder to process the waste products from formula. He needs more of any medication to get the same effect. His immune system's response to vaccinations is less effective. The risk of SIDS, sudden infant death syndrome, or crib death, and infant death from many other causes, is higher if a baby isn't breastfed. As an older child or adult, he is at a greater risk of Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, type 1 diabetes, heart disease, and certain cancers. He responds to stress more negatively and has higher blood pressure, both as an infant and in later life. There's a higher risk of obesity, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, and osteoporosis in later years. There are numerous IQ studies showing deficits in children who didn't breastfeed, or who didn't breastfeed for long. Colostrum, the milk you produce in small amounts in the first couple of days after your baby is born, and which you started producing during your pregnancy, has concentrated immunological properties that are your baby's first protection against all the germs he is suddenly exposed to. This first milk contains high concentrations of secretory immunoglobulin A, or SIGA, an anti-infective agent that coats his intestines to protect against the passage of germs and foreign proteins that could create allergic sensitivities. Scientists have also recently discovered a new ingredient in human milk called pancreatic secretory trypsin inhibitor, PSTI, which protects and repairs the infant intestine. It's present in all human milk, but it's 7 times higher in colostrum, providing extra protection to that delicate and vulnerable newborn intestine. Think of colostrum as a complex paint designed to seal those brand new intestinal walls, which were, of course, designed to receive it. Colostrum has an acid level that encourages a baby's intestines to welcome just the right mix of beneficial bacteria. And colostrum is a laxative that gets his intestines up and running and helps clean out all the tar-like stool called meconium that built up in his system before birth. Mature milk, which phases in during the first 2 weeks, has a still unknown number of ingredients that contribute to lifelong health. Along with the interferon, interleukins, white blood cells, and SIGA, the breastfed baby gains an immune system nearly as sturdy as his mother's. Human growth factor continues to develop those intestines, bones, and other organs. Insulin for digestion, long-chain fatty acids for a healthy heart, lactose for brain development. It's all there. And just as important, it's there in forms that are available to a baby. Iron is added to formulas in forms that the baby can't readily use, and which can actually be harmful, since it increases the risk of intestinal infection, intestinal bleeding, and anemia. The mechanics of breastfeeding are important, too. When your baby breastfeeds, the muscles in his jaws are exercised and massaged in a way that causes the bones in his face and jaw to develop more fully. The jaw that results from bottle feeding and pacifiers is narrower, with a higher palate that's more likely to restrict nose breathing. Babies who use pacifiers instead of soothing themselves at the breast are more likely to need speech therapy later. The child who breastfeeds for less than a year is much more likely to need orthodontia later on. Snoring and related breathing problems are more common as well. Your baby can design his own meal to suit his needs. If he's thirsty, he nurses for a shorter amount of time and gets a lower-fat milk. Still thirsty? He asks to switch sides sooner, and gets another thirst quencher from the other side. Extra hungry? He stays longer on the first side, or nurses more vigorously to pull down more higher-calorie fat globules. Going through a growth spurt? If your baby takes more milk than usual, he'll have more milk available the very next time he nurses. If he drinks less than usual, your milk production scales back. Is he moving into toddlerhood and nursing less often? There will be more immune factors in your milk to keep him covered. Did he pick up some germs from the grocery cart handle? He communicates those germs to your breast at his next nursing, and it starts cranking out specialized antibodies. In a whole lot of different ways, your breast is health central for your baby. Breastfeeding helps keep you healthy, too. Breastfeeding is the natural next step in the reproduction sequence, pregnancy to birth to lactation. When your newborn takes your breast soon after delivery, your uterus contracts and bleeding slows. Hemorrhage is a greater risk with formula feeding, and your belly stays larger longer. If you breastfeed exclusively, without giving water, solids, or formula, and your baby nurses often, including at least once during the night, then your periods most likely won't come back for at least 6 months. Your chances of getting pregnant again will be extremely low during that time, too. Refer to Chapter 8 for details. Breastfeeding helps many, not all, women lose weight readily. Nature gave you some of that pregnancy weight just for the purpose of making milk in the first few months. The natural design is for it to melt away by the time your baby is well started on solids. Women who haven't breastfed are at greater risk for metabolic syndrome, a cluster of risk factors that makes heart disease and diabetes more likely. If you already have insulin-dependent diabetes, you're likely to need less insulin while you're a nursing mother. Breastfeeding is also an insurance policy against breast, uterine, and cervical cancer. It may be that the lower estrogen level of lactation provides the protection. The longer you breastfeed, the stronger your insurance. This doesn't mean it's impossible for you to get these cancers if you breastfeed, but you are less susceptible to them. Osteoporosis and fractures are also more common in women who didn't breastfeed. A formula-feeding mother's blood pressure is likely to be higher, probably because her neurological and endocrine responses are more pronounced than those of a nursing mother. Her overall physical and mental health take a hit as well. And in later years, she remains at an increased risk of developing such autoimmune diseases as rheumatoid arthritis. I didn't realize what immeasurable joy breastfeeding could give me. I thought it was supposed to be about giving to the baby, not to the mother. Those hormones just poured into me, and I was in a blissed-out, euphoric state when I was breastfeeding. And, I have to say, it gave this very unconfident mom something I could finally feel confident and proud of myself for. Samantha. How reliable is breastfeeding research? You've probably heard that breastfeeding reduces the risk of infection and a bunch of childhood and adult illnesses and diseases, that it reduces the risk of allergy, and that it even raises IQ. But are you sitting down? None of this is true. Here's why. Let's say we're testing a new drug. We focus on the people who get the drug, with a group of ordinary people to compare them with. That's how we know what the drug did. It made things better or worse than normal. Accurate science focuses on the experiment, not the normal thing. Now, think about most of the research on breastfeeding. Exactly. It's research on breastfeeding. And that means that virtually all our recent research was done backward, evaluating what's normal, breastfeeding, instead of evaluating the experiment, formula. It makes the high rates of formula-fed illness seem like normal baby health, and breastfeeding seem like bonus points. Breastfeeding doesn't reduce the risk of infection, illness, and disease. It doesn't add IQ points. Breastfeeding results in normal good health and normal IQ. When babies aren't breastfed, and this is using the same information from the same studies, just shifting the focus to the true experimental group. They are at increased risk for all those short-term and long-term illnesses and diseases. Researchers have inadvertently hidden formula problems from us by focusing on the apparently fabulous benefits of human milk and breastfeeding, almost as if breastfeeding is a nice but unnecessary extra. That's starting to change. More and more research articles are using the normal breastfed baby as the starting point, as good science requires, and are looking at what happens to babies when their normal system is altered. It can be a scary way for the public to look at infant feeding, to see a list of risks instead of a list of benefits. But it's a more honest, accurate approach. And it's the one we've used. Breastfeeding doesn't give you brownie points. It's simply the normal way to raise a baby. Breastfeeding is a safety net against the worst effects of poverty. Exclusive breastfeeding goes a long way toward canceling out the health differences between being born into poverty and being born into affluence. Unless the mother is in extremely poor nutritional health, the breast milk of a mother in an African village is as good as the breast milk of a mother in a Manhattan apartment. James P. Grant, former executive director of UNICEF. Breastfeeding deepens your attachment to each other. Before you even picked up this book, you probably heard plenty about the nutrition and immunities in human milk. But if you talk to most experienced breastfeeding mothers, they're more likely to focus on the way breastfeeding helps you and your baby feel connected and attached to each other, weaving an emotional cord to replace the umbilical cord. It's all part of the way nature encourages us to take care of our babies and transition from birth. There's a surge of hormones in your body every single time you breastfeed that makes you feel loving and nurturing. These hormones, prolactin, P-R-O-L-A-C-T-I-N, and oxytocin, O-X-Y-T-O-C-I-N, not only foster a connection with your baby, they also help you recover from the emotional and physical stress of birth. Without these hormones, mothers tend to talk to their babies less, interact less, touch less. As for your baby, breastfeeding is what he's born to expect. His nursing relationship with you becomes the foundation of the way he will think of himself and others. One mother pointed out that it's as if bottles fill his stomach, but breastfeeding fills his soul. Many bottle-feeding mothers wish they had breastfed, yet very, very few breastfeeding mothers wish they had bottle-fed. This isn't to say that mothers who are bottle-feeding don't love and value their babies, but there's a difference. When a formula-feeding mother hears her baby fuss or cry, she responds using her mind. When a breastfeeding mother hears her baby make the little sounds that mean he wants to nurse, her whole body chemistry responds. There's a difference in the intimacy of the feeding, too, that a baby can feel. When a mother bottle feeds, she holds the baby loosely or off to the side so her breasts don't get in the way. The baby feels her clothes against his face and hands. As the baby gets older and more curious about the world, the mother may find it's easier if he faces away from her, or if the baby holds the bottle himself. When a mother breastfeeds, her body is the feeding, with the baby's cheeks on the mother's skin, and the whole nursing is a full-body hug. The emotional connection created by those repeated full-body hugs is a strong one. After only a short time, you'll probably find that being away from each other, especially in the early months, can be just as difficult for you emotionally as it is for your milk supply. This is a good thing for your relationship, now and for the future. The breastfeeding experience can also help heal many emotional wounds, from a difficult or traumatic birth to an abusive past. Baby blues are more common in societies such as ours, where mother and baby are not able to stay together, nursing from birth. When my kids were teenagers, people were often surprised by our still close relationship. Our long late-night conversations about everything from their girlfriends or boyfriends and school issues to politics and the future of the world. Other parents would ask me what I did to have this kind of relationship, and it was hard to tell them because I'd have to start out with, Well, first you breastfeed until they wean themselves. Anne. Breastfeeding helps teach you how to be a mother. Breastfeeding eases you into your identity as a mother. You're your baby's food source, and you're the one who can comfort him best, so you're the one he turns to. Your body responds instinctively. You don't have to think through what to do once you get the hang of it. With all this intimate time together, you get to know his body and his personality better than anyone else. You know how to interpret his cries sooner than your partner. You know what makes him happy and what he doesn't like. Day by day, breastfeeding builds your confidence and mothering skills. Many women are surprised by the passion they come to feel about breastfeeding. If you meet another breastfeeding woman anywhere in the world, you feel a connection. No matter how different her culture is, and no matter how long ago you or she breastfed your babies. Not many of us felt this passionately about breastfeeding until we did it ourselves. And many of us remember it as one of the best things we do in our lives. The experience is just that powerful. I live near a community of Old Order Mennonites. While we shop at many of the same stores, usually all we do is nod and smile. But when I showed up with my baby and sat on a bench near the river to breastfeed him, three other mothers wearing long dresses and bonnets and carrying babies of their own came over and sat by me. They asked how old my son was, admired his big blue eyes, and showed off their own infants. As we sat together breastfeeding our babies, our different ways of life seemed unimportant. We were breastfeeding mothers, and that was all that mattered. Teresa. What is established in the breastfeeding relationship constitutes the foundation for the development of all human social relationships, and the communications the infant receives through the warmth of the mother's skin constitute the first of the socializing experiences of life. Ashley Montague in Touching, 1971. And then there are the practical reasons. After the early weeks, when you've learned the ropes and breastfeeding becomes second nature, you'll find you can gentle your baby out of almost anything. Hunger, tiredness, overstimulation, fear, pain, with a little nursing. Breastfeeding stops being a feeding device and becomes an all-purpose mothering tool. It's these little social at-breast exchanges, in fact, that keep your milk supply in good shape and your baby growing well. Scheduling nursings, like scheduling kisses, would just make life harder for both of you. In fact, one of the nicest things about breastfeeding is that it lets you take little breaks throughout your busy day. Nursing becomes efficient and easy. Your life may seem to speed up faster and faster, but when you're breastfeeding, you'll have to take time to gather him in your arms and be still for a few minutes. A few deep breaths later, life seems simple again. Some mothers say they don't want to breastfeed because they don't want to be tied down. But most breastfeeding mothers will tell you that breastfeeding actually frees them up. No cans of formula or bottles, no washing, sterilizing, or storing, no measuring, spilling, or heating, no planning, leftovers, or spoilage. Most likely a lot fewer trips to the doctor. Your milk is always available, always the right temperature, and never spoiled, no matter how hot or cold it is outside. The money that you don't spend on formula in a year could pay for a high-end appliance. And, this is a big one, in an emergency of any kind, from a minor problem to a natural disaster that means shortages of formula and clean water to prepare it, breastfeeding your baby is one way to ensure you'll always have a way to feed him. I was once on a plane with my 2-year-old nursling, Quinn. There were thunderstorms, and we circled the airport for 2 hours because we couldn't land safely. Eventually, we were diverted to another airport, 2 hours away, for fuel. We sat on the tarmac for 3 hours more before we got clearance to take off for the original destination 2 hours away. None of the passengers were allowed off the plane, and no food or drinks were served, not even water. Quinn and I were perfectly happy, nursing and playing to keep each other company. But a formula-fed baby and his mother were nearly hysterical because she had run out of formula after about the first 2 hours of our unexpected 9-hour delay. Diana. Will my breasts work? There's a wide range of normal. Big breasts to small, low breasts to high, soft breasts to firm, long nipples to short, flat nipples to round, to multi-lobed, and more. We're all built differently, and most of us don't look like the women in the breastfeeding videos. Your baby will love your shape, whatever it is. Breast size doesn't matter. How much milk you make isn't related to how big your breasts are. There are a few breast shapes and breasts that have had surgery that have trouble making enough milk. And some women do need to breastfeed more often than others to keep a good supply flowing. But there are many ways to help any breast-related problems. Nipple size doesn't matter. Most babies can give you a hickey or bruise by just sucking on your neck. They don't usually need an ideal nipple in order to latch, just a little matching of parts. If the nipple is too big or wide for the baby to latch, the baby just needs to grow until he has a bit bigger mouth, and then he'll do fine. Some otherwise prominent nipples become temporarily flat right after birth if too many intravenous IV fluids during birth caused the breast to swell. Some nipples are tucked inside the breast, inverted, instead of sticking out. But there are ways to help them untuck. So it doesn't matter what size your nipples and breasts are. Sure, there are some breast or nipple types that require extra effort, especially at first, but breastfeeding can almost always work. You'll find tips for breastfeeding with all kinds of different nipples and breasts in Chapter 18. Will my baby latch? Your baby is born expecting to breastfeed. He has many innate reflexes designed to help him do it well, even if his birth is tough or problems come up. Babies are designed to deal with difficult births, cold, hunger, separation, and germs, and still breastfeed well. It's how babies have survived difficult environments throughout history. Maybe you've seen some of the videos of newborns placed on their mother's bodies right after birth, who wriggle their way to the breast and latch without help from anyone. Your baby will have those same instincts, and he'll have to have you help him along. It's not all on your shoulders to make breastfeeding work. Your baby is built for this, with all the reflexes he needs. You provide the access and support. Your own breastfeeding instincts will guide you to providing the support your baby needs. Most mothers, without even thinking about it, pick up a crying baby and hold him vertically so that the baby's chest and tummy are against her shoulder and chest. Why is this a good position? Well, it not only calms the baby, but also puts him in a good spot to head toward the breast if he's hungry. Calming, access, and support. And we do it without a thought. It's true, though, that today we see more babies who can't get their act together for a while. This is usually because their systems are overwhelmed with birth medications and interventions. Chapter 3 will help you understand and avoid, or at least minimize, the possibility of this happening. If your baby does have difficulty latching, there's helpful information in Chapter 18. Will breastfeeding hurt? When a mother cat feeds her kittens, she's not thinking about how much milk each kitty is getting or what the latch looks like. She just lies there, usually purring, and lets them nurse. If it hurts, though, if one kitten gets on at a bad angle or gets too aggressive, mother cat reacts. She moves her body a little, nudges the kitten with her nose, or if it's uncomfortable enough, gets up, shakes the kittens off, and starts over. Same for humans. Nipple sensitivity is common in the early days, but if breastfeeding actually hurts, that's your body's signal to change something. As Christina Smilly, a physician specializing in breastfeeding, says, pain is the body's way of guiding us to find a more comfortable position. If you get a pebble in your sandal, you don't keep walking on the pebble. You'll stop to do something, maybe shake your foot to get the pebble out. If that doesn't work, you'll intuitively do something else, so you can walk comfortably. Most nipple pain is that simple, solved with a few simple changes that we'll explain in Chapter 4. Nipple pain and damage are not normal, not for cats and not for humans. Will I have enough milk? It's natural to worry about it, especially if a lot of your friends didn't seem to have enough. But most mothers are able to make plenty of milk. The chances are really good that you will be able to as well. Some women do have difficulties with milk production, but most of the reasons are fixable. Sometimes the mother was given wrong information about breastfeeding, and sometimes it's because the baby had a problem removing milk effectively. Medicalized births can make it difficult to get breastfeeding off to a good start. Sometimes the mother has a hormonal problem that affects her ability to make milk, and occasionally women have anatomical problems that make breastfeeding difficult, such as previous breast surgery or a breast or nipple problem. So, yes, there are mothers who face challenges in making a generous milk supply. But there are lots of ways to increase your milk supply that we'll explain in later chapters. And LLL leaders are ready to help you at any time. If you suspect that you may have temporary supply problems for any reason, consider hand-expressing some colostrum to freeze ahead of time. Refer to Chapter 15 for a hand-expression technique. Not only can it give you a small, just-in-case, supply of colostrum, but there's some evidence that it may also boost your future supply. If, despite all the best information and help, you aren't able to make a full milk supply, you can still breastfeed successfully. There are many mothers who nurse very satisfactorily with a partial milk supply. They supplement to make up for the amount of milk they can't make, but their main focus is on the milk they can make. They look at the breast as half full rather than half empty. It's all in how you think about it. One mother with an unusual condition could produce only about 1 teaspoon, 5 milliliters, of milk each day. She thought of the milk as medicine for her baby, which she very proudly gave him each day. Every single drop of your milk that your baby gets is wonderfully beneficial, containing all the immunities of a full milk supply and many, many elements that are completely absent from formula. How long will I be doing this? The short answer is, as long as you and your baby want. You may have an idea now about when you want to stop. Once things are going smoothly, you may decide to keep going longer than you'd originally intended. Unfortunately, many women end up weaning sooner than they had planned, because they ran into challenges and didn't know how to get help. That's not likely to happen to you, of course, because you have this book and access to the resources of LLL, including the support of other mothers you'll find at LLL meetings. What do the experts recommend? Based on research, the World Health Organization and many national pediatric associations around the world advise exclusive breastfeeding, no other drinks or solid foods, for about 6 months, with solid foods gradually added and breastfeeding continuing for at least 2 years. Can't imagine nursing a 2-year-old? Not many of us can when we have a new baby. For that matter, it's hard to imagine what it's like caring for a 2-year-old when you've never done it. For now, focus on feeding your new baby and getting help if you need it. Then, when breastfeeding is going smoothly, you'll be able to make decisions about when you want to stop from a position of strength, instead of stopping because you had no choice. When you're ready to think about weaning, we have an in-depth discussion in Chapter 16. What stuff do I need for breastfeeding? There are lots of products sold for breastfeeding mothers, but a breastfeeding baby really doesn't need much. Here are our thoughts on the most common products you'll hear about. Nursing clothes? Not really. Clothes made especially for nursing with hidden flaps and access to the breasts are nice, but certainly not necessary. Most mothers just wear a top that's loose enough to pull up from the hem. Your shirt can droop over the baby and hide any bare skin. Or you can wear a shirt that buttons in front and unbutton it from the bottom. You can also wear a loose jacket or overshirt with a t-shirt or tank top underneath to cover a bit more. Nursing bras? Not necessarily. Bras are never a health necessity. If you're happy braless, stay braless. If you like wearing one, figure that whatever you wore in your last trimester will probably fit after your baby's born, though your cup size may run somewhat bigger for the first couple of months. You'll probably want two or three. A regular bra that's loose enough and flexible enough that you can pull the cup down or up to breastfeed works well for many mothers. It's a good idea to avoid underwires, at least at first. They can cut across milk-making tissue and increase the risk of milk plugs or infections. Avoid any bra that's tight enough to leave marks on your skin. Some mothers find that bras made for nursing are handy because they have flaps that open for easy access without having to remove the bra for each feeding. They come in many different styles and fabrics, but cotton is usually the most comfortable. Better quality nursing bras stand up better to a lot of wear and tear. You'll find good ones at specialty breastfeeding and maternity stores in your area and online. La Leche League carries a line of good quality nursing bras online at lliclothes.com and in select stores at lliclothes.com/locations.html. A really good place to ask about bras is at a La Leche League meeting where women are happy to share what they've learned. Breast or nursing pads? It depends. Some women find breast pads helpful to soak up leaking milk, but some breasts never leak at all. Leaking has nothing to do with milk supply. Both disposable and washable brands are available. Or you can make your own washable pads from layers of soft cotton circles sewn together. Many women leave a cloth diaper here and there around the house to catch any drips while they're nursing and don't need pads in between. Breast pump? Not always. If you won't be separated regularly, you probably don't need a pump at all. Many breastfeeding mothers never need to pump or express their milk. If you want to have one for unexpected separations or the occasional night out with your partner, hand expression or a good quality manual pump may be all you need. Manual pumps are relatively inexpensive and may remove milk better than the mid-priced electric pumps available at discount stores and drugstores. Hand expression works fine, too, and doesn't cost a thing. Go to Chapter 15 for an explanation of how to hand express your milk. If you're going to go back to work while your baby is still small, this is a good time to investigate pumps. Refer to Chapter 15. Nursing footstool? Not necessarily. Mothers who nurse sitting up and have short legs may find that a low stool raises their lap to support their baby and relaxes their lower back. But mothers who lean back slightly when they nurse, or who simply cross one knee over the other, may have no need for a nursing stool at all. If you use one, it doesn't have to be a commercial product. A thick book, diaper bag, or coffee table crossbar works too. As you become more practiced, you'll find other creative ways to get comfortable. Try raising just one foot so your baby's feet are lower than his head. Soft carrier? Almost always. One of the most helpful tools of motherhood is a cloth carrier, sling, or wrap, so you can wear your baby while you go about your day, inside or out. Babies get heavy fast, and it's much easier on your back and arms to have your baby secured to you in fabric that holds him against your body. You can use a carrier from birth until he is about 35 to 40 pounds, 16 to 18 kilograms, much heavier than you'll be able to manage with a car seat. Mothers in all cultures have used slings to make life easier. Many a baby who cried the first time will get excited when he sees his sling a few months later. Having your hands free is great, but baby wearing is even more important to your baby. Research shows that babies who aren't worn by adults for much of the day fuss more than those who are. We're not just talking mothers here. Diana's husband Brad used to carry their sons in slings when he'd take them with him to run errands. Teresa's grown son Matthew carries his baby in a sling with fabric featuring the logo of his favorite hockey team. Carriers come in all kinds of fabrics, from mesh to cotton to luxurious washable silk, and in all kinds of colors and patterns. There are many different designs, from ones that tie in a crisscross pattern to the basic kind that is secured with two large rings. They're not only baby carriers, they're also a clean surface for diaper changing, in a pinch, and a blanket to cover a sleeping baby. Most people won't be able to tell when you nurse your baby in a sling. Some even have pockets for your cell phone and keys. And there are sizes to fit all body types. Patterns for sewing your own custom sling or carrier are available from several companies online. Sewing can be as simple as two straight seams, and many are just a length of fabric, no sewing needed. Simple styles often work best. Wearing a carrier does take a bit of practice, and how you use it, even which one you use, may change as your baby grows. Be sure it's cinched firmly so your baby is secure and fairly upright against your chest, not flopping loosely in a hammock. And avoid positions that have the baby with his head tucked toward his chest. Google sling instructions, check with other mothers at LLL meetings, take a look at Chapter 6, or just keep experimenting until you find what works for you and your baby. Nursing is the best thing I've ever done, besides having Leah. Kate, a mother whose baby didn't latch for 2 weeks, who had sore nipples for 2 months, who never had a full milk supply, and who ultimately breastfed with joy and fulfillment into toddlerhood. What do I need to do to prepare my body? Not much. All the heavy-duty preparation is automatic. Before your very first period, some of your earliest milk-carrying ducts were formed at this time, looking something like a cluster of sapling trunks and small branches. Separate trunks, ducts, began forming behind your nipple, from which the smaller branches grew. Before each period, pre-pregnancy, your ducts added more and more branches. The branches themselves began to sprout buds, and milk-making tissue grew, causing the breast tenderness you may have felt just before your period. During the first 3 months of pregnancy, growth accelerates at this time and more buds are added. Your breasts are probably more tender now than before your periods, and all that internal growth will probably cause visibly larger breasts in the coming months. Each bud grows into a tiny cluster of milk-making cells called an alveolus, A-L-V-E-O-L-U-S. These alveoli, A-L-V-E-O-L-I, are hollow, surrounded by microscopic bands of muscle. Milk will collect in the hollow center of each alveolus, will be squeezed out by those tiny muscles, and will follow the ductal branches and trunks toward your nipple. Some of the ducts will join along the way, so that you will probably have between 4 and 18 nipple pores where the milk flows out. Now, take a look at the outside of your breasts. They might begin to have visible blue veins, and your areole, A-R-E-O-L-A-E, or one areola, A-R-E-O-L-A, the dark area around your nipples, may be getting darker and possibly larger. You may notice small bumps begin to form on your areole, Montgomery glands, which secrete a small amount of oil and maybe milk after the baby comes, and which may help to keep your nipples clean and moisturized. If you've always felt that your breasts looked different, or if you're not experiencing any tenderness or changes, consider talking to a breastfeeding-savvy healthcare provider and take a look at Chapter 18 to get breastfeeding off to the best possible start. During the middle 3 months of pregnancy, breast growth continues inside and out during the second trimester. Lifting and shifting your breasts will give you a better sense of their changing weight and contour, and increase your comfort with a part of your body that you may never have handled before. Moving your breasts. Here's an idea worth pondering. Cheryl Chapman is a nurse, massage therapist, and author of The Happy Breast Book, who suggests that all women, especially pregnant and nursing mothers, move their breasts at least twice a day. She believes that this has many benefits, including improved lymph draining to remove toxins and improve the immune system, reduce breast tenderness during pregnancy, and improve a woman's awareness of changes in her breasts. Bend at the waist, cup your hands under each breast, and gently move your hands in an up-and-down motion, as if fluffing a pillow. It will give your breasts a chance to shift and move a bit. During the last 3 months of pregnancy, In the last trimester, many mothers can express, or even leak, drops of colostrum, the thick, yellowish, or other-colored early milk that is your baby's first food. It's a mixture of carbohydrates, sugars, proteins, lipids, fats, and immune factors. If you express colostrum, you'll make more to replace it. There isn't a finite amount. And if a pregnancy ends at any time from this point on, almost all mothers will automatically begin full milk production within a few days. These last 3 months are a great time to learn hand expression. Even though it's usually just drops, or less, learning how to hand express is a skill that may come in handy in the months to come. Refer to Chapter 15 for a description of how to do it. After birth, the hormonal wall that held back milk production comes down when your placenta is delivered. In the first few days, the alveoli continue to secrete colostrum. The sugar and fat content rise dramatically on about the third or fourth day, pulling additional water and many other elements into the alveoli, so your milk is now whiter and increased in volume. Mothers often say that this is their milk coming in. But the basics were there from the start, though in smaller amounts and with different concentrations. During the first 2 weeks, the extra sugar, water, and fats keep increasing the volume. All of this will happen whether or not milk is removed, even if you do nothing at all, even if you don't want to breastfeed. Your body's going to do everything it can to feed your baby. Your gradual increase in milk gives your baby time to practice everything from breathing to digesting. By about 10 days, you're near full production, and your supply won't increase much from about 1 month on. Your baby may have growth spurts when he nurses a lot and increases your supply for a few days, but then he'll slow down and your production will return to its usual level. Shortly after your baby is born, your milk production will start to work on a supply and demand system, meaning that the amount of new milk created depends on how much has been taken out. The resulting milk-making process can continue for years once it starts, but only as long as milk keeps being removed from the breasts. Milk removal is especially important during the first 2 to 3 weeks, because that's when your milk production capability is established. It's like calibrating your milk supply, and it happens all over again with each new baby. Each breast is calibrated independently. The more milk you remove during the early weeks, the more milk you'll be able to make for this baby. If you don't remove much milk in the first few weeks, it will be harder, but not impossible, to make more milk later on. The system is built to work, even with a rough start. But getting started well helps a lot. Once you start, milk is always being made. It's made more rapidly when the breast is less full. The fuller the breast, the more slowly milk is made. This is why your milk production slows down if you wait to feed your baby until your breasts fill up. It's also why your breasts are never truly empty. When your baby nurses, nerves in the nipple and areola send a signal to the pituitary to release a hormone called oxytocin. Oxytocin causes those little muscles around the alveoli to squeeze, building milk pressure inside the breast and creating a milk release, or milk ejection reflex, or letdown. The tiny ducts yawn open as milk spurts down them. You might feel a tingling in your breasts or shoulder blades. You might feel thirsty or sleepy, or you might feel nothing at all. In the early weeks, a milk release may be triggered just by thinking about nursing or by hearing a baby, any baby, cry. Your body wants to breastfeed. What do I need to do to prepare my head? Talk to friends and relatives who've enjoyed breastfeeding. If you know anyone who's currently breastfeeding, hang out with her. Do some reading. If you can, check out a La Leche League meeting. Pregnant women are always welcome. No pressure, no commitment. Even watching casually, you'll pick up a lot of little tips and tricks that will help a lot. This will all help you picture yourself happily feeding your baby at your breast. Most important, decide this is something you are going to do, not something you are going to try to do. That can make all the difference. Most women who can't breastfeed simply don't have enough information or support. With this book in your hands, you have a lot of both. Now, all it takes to become a breastfeeding mother is the realization that you already are one. Breastfeeding resources. Some other good breastfeeding books. The Breastfeeding Cafe by Barbara Behrman. Breastfeeding Made Simple by Nancy Moorbacher and Kathleen Kendall Tackett. So That's What They're For by Janet Tomorrow. The Ultimate Breastfeeding Book of Answers by Jack Newman and Teresa Pitman. Some good breastfeeding videos. Baby-led Breastfeeding, The Mother-Baby Dance by Christina Smilley. Biological Nurturing, Laid-Back Breastfeeding by Suzanne Colson. Follow Me, Mum, The Key to Successful Breastfeeding by Rebecca Glover. Breastfeeding, A Guide for Success by the Northwest Georgia Breastfeeding Coalition. Some good breastfeeding websites, LLLI.org, La Leche League International, ILCA.org, International Lactation Consultant Association, USBreastfeeding.org, U.S. Breastfeeding Committee, LowMilkSupply.org, Diana West and Lisa Marasco's website, NormalFed.com, Diane Wiessinger's website, KellyMom.com, Kelly Bunyata's website. Who will help me? Everyone will want to help you breastfeed your baby. Formula companies, furniture companies, pump companies, baby food companies, ointment and cream companies, relatives, friends, websites, and, authors. They'll all tell you how helpful they can be. And they all have different styles and levels of expertise. Almost all have good intentions and want to help you breastfeed successfully, with the notable exception of those funded by formula companies, who have a different agenda altogether. But commercial companies put their own bottom line first. Friends think their own experiences are how it always works. Not all experts are, and not all websites or books will suit your style. Here are some helpers that you may get to pick from, in the order in which you're likely to meet them, with some pros and cons. Who is she or he? La Leche League leader. How can she or he help with breastfeeding? In-person and phone help, leading meetings, finding information and resources. Points to remember. Is an experienced nursing mother, not usually medically trained, can direct you to medical and other resources in your community. Who is she or he? Obstetrician. How can she or he help with breastfeeding? Minimizing interventions and keeping you and your baby together. Points to remember. May have little or no breastfeeding training. Who is she or he? Midwife. How can she or he help with breastfeeding? Facilitating normal birth and keeping you and your baby together. Points to remember. May have little or no training in breastfeeding. Who is she or he? Doula. How can she or he help with breastfeeding? Help with a smoother birth and early breastfeeding. Points to remember. Usually trained in basic breastfeeding help. Some postpartum doulas have had extra training. Who is she or he? Hospital nurse. How can she or he help with breastfeeding? Keeping mother and baby together. Points to remember. May have little or no training in breastfeeding. Who is she or he? Pediatrician. How can she or he help with breastfeeding? Keeping mother and baby together. Points to remember. May have little or no training in breastfeeding. Who is she or he? Lactation consultant, lactation counselor, lactation educator, peer counselor, breastfeeding specialist. How can she or he help with breastfeeding? May be able to help with basic breastfeeding problems. Points to remember. Titles have no standardized or legal meaning. Individuals may have very little or no experience helping mothers. Who is she or he? International Board Certified Lactation Consultant, IBCLC. How can she or he help with breastfeeding? Experienced and legally certified to give breastfeeding help in special situations. Points to remember. May not have breastfed own children. At La Leche League, and in this meeting in a book, we are sharing information based on research and on the experience of generations of mothers. But at the end of the day, we can't go home with you, and our lives won't be affected by the decisions you make. You need to do what's right for you and your family. When it comes to breastfeeding, the decisions are always up to you. Listen to your heart and trust that you know or will know your baby better than anyone else, because you are your baby's mother. Chapter 2. Building Your Network. I never questioned how I would feed my own babies. Babies nursed. This was just the way my world worked. And this, I thought, was normal. Then I had a child of my own, and the questions and comments started. I quickly realized, to most of America, the way I had been raised was anything but normal. I had grown up in a bubble without realizing it, and now I had moved outside the bubble. It was hard to face the criticism, stated and implied, but everything I knew, from science, from my faith, from my upbringing, and from my own experience with my daughter, told me that no other way of parenting could provide what my child and my family needed. Thanks to my mother, I had plenty of support and information only a phone call away. But surrounded by startling evidence of the abnormality of what I was doing, I started to long for and found local support, other women with young children to whom I could talk without feeling weird. Now I have friends with whom I can freely discuss the joys and challenges of toddler nursing, a small version of my childhood bubble where I know that I am normal, that my child is normal, and that what we are doing is right. Secure in this knowledge, I can take a little bit of that confidence with me into the rest of the world and surprise a few people with how well my weird ideas work. And just as my mother did for me, I'll nurse my children as long as they need to, even if this raises eyebrows when we go out. And they will be taught that all this is normal, because it is. Newt, Remembering 2002. If you're listening to this audiobook from start to finish, instead of just dipping into it for the information you want, you may wonder why this section is near the beginning. Why aren't we starting with the how-tos of initiating breastfeeding? Why are we talking about building a network of support when your baby may not even be born yet? Here's why. Being part of a supportive community is more important than you might think in succeeding at breastfeeding and smoothing the way to parenthood. It really is part of the basic how-to. The statistics tell the story. Today, the majority of new mothers in almost every country in the world opt for breastfeeding. As a new breastfeeding mother, you're in good company. But the statistics also tell us that, in many places, most of those mothers stop breastfeeding within a few weeks or months, usually earlier than they had wanted to. What goes wrong? There's no one answer. Every mother's story is unique. Often, though, those many individual challenges that led to weaning can be boiled down to one thing: not having the support network they needed. You'll sometimes hear at La Leche League meetings that people are more important than things. It's true once you have your baby, but it's also true when you are getting ready. In the last chapter, we talked about nesting, being more about preparing your mind, getting to know your breasts, and arranging to keep your baby close than it is about buying baby equipment. Nesting is also about gathering the people you'll need around you. What kind of practical help will you want? What kind of emotional support? Who do you want to be in touch with to share stories, concerns, and those moments of pure joy? That's the foundation of your community, your village, your extended family, your network. We're designed to have networks. Different types of mammals live in different ways. Some are almost always found in groups or herds or packs, like dolphins, horses, and elephants. Others are more solitary, like tigers and bears. Force an elephant to live alone, and you'll have a very unhappy elephant who won't be able to care for her babies well. So what about people? How do humans normally live? If you look at our ancestors and at people in the developing world, you'll see people in tribes and villages, small communities, often of people who are related to one another in some way, where everyone pretty much knows everyone else. We're not like bears, happy to live alone in our caves. We're a lot more like elephants, who crave the company of other elephants. Traditional tribes are usually made up of people from several generations, great-grandparents, grandparents, parents, and children. When a baby comes along, there are plenty of experienced relatives to help and support the new family. In fact, new parents probably don't need much advice and information. In traditional tribes, where babies are part of everyday life, the new mom and dad have been watching other parents since they were babies themselves, and they've absorbed most of the skills they need without even trying. They've had plenty of chances to practice, too, because they've been carrying and soothing and entertaining babies, their own siblings and cousins and neighbors, for many years. So the new mother in this traditional village is pretty confident about breastfeeding. She's watched everyone else around her do it. She's seen the variations, and she knows that sometimes people have challenges. Their nipples got sore, or they get plugged ducts or mastitis. But she's also seen people solve those problems, so she knows they can be fixed. She's watched mothers breastfeeding in every imaginable position, including walking around to see what their toddlers are up to. And she has a mental image of the way that breastfeeding looks when it's working well. So does her partner. Babies operate on pure instinct at first. Who would they have watched and learned from ahead of time? But they have to be in the right place at the right time to make it work. That's the mother's job, and that's partly learned. Even elephants struggle to feed their babies if they haven't learned it by observation. So it can be hard for a new mother today. Your mother might not have breastfed at all, or only for a short time. The images that you carry around in your brain of babies being fed might feature more bottles than breasts. And support can be hard to find. One mother commented that before she had her baby, her childless friends all promised to visit and help out. Maybe they would have helped, but we were in a new baby fog and didn't call. They didn't call because they didn't want to intrude. We'll be glad to help out ended up being one dinner a month later. The support we'd counted on from casual friends really wasn't there. Every situation is different, and you may have a family around you that understands and supports breastfeeding, or a ready-made circle of friends who are experienced nursing mothers. Or you may be trying to build your support network from scratch. One great place to start is La Leche League. La Leche League. When those seven mothers created La Leche League in the 1950s, they were just thinking of providing information to other mothers. But for many women, their local LLL group became a kind of community or extended family, exactly the kind they needed, a place where breastfeeding is normal. At La Leche League, because breastfeeding is recognized as the normal way of feeding a baby, difficulties are just something to resolve in order to keep a normal process going. That's not always the case with mothers' groups. Go to some of them and ask a question like, "My baby wakes up a lot at night and I'm really tired. What can I do?" The responses often zero in on breastfeeding as the probable cause of the problem, with suggestions that your baby shouldn't be eating that often, that you don't have enough milk, that formula would help, or that your partner should take the night shift, bottle in hand. Breastfeeding itself isn't the problem in this situation, and formula isn't the answer. But breastfed babies are still unusual in many communities, so people figure that any problems are probably related to it, even when the mother hasn't really asked about feeding. You'll hear some different answers at La Leche League meetings. We know that many baby behaviors, including wanting to be held, needing to nurse again, and waking at night, are perfectly normal. And we can help you figure out ways to meet your baby's needs and your own without sacrificing breastfeeding. Whatever question you have, whatever concerns are worrying you, at La Leche League meetings, we'll try to help you in a way that keeps the normalness of breastfeeding in mind. So La Leche League can be one cornerstone of your network. Who else? Other than mother. Most new mothers have a life partner, a husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, significant other, or whatever name you give your relationship. It may also be a non-parent, such as a grandmother, other relative, or close friend. Your partner is another cornerstone of your tribe, and his or her support can make a huge difference to your breastfeeding experience. But this person can also be at a huge disadvantage when it comes to supporting you. He or she may be enthusiastic about breastfeeding and knowledgeable about all the reasons it's important. But when problems crop up, that person may feel helpless. If you're crying because your nipples hurt and the baby never seems satisfied, your partner has a big dilemma. Tell you to keep trying, or even try to repeat some of the suggestions the midwife made at her last home visit, and risk being labeled insensitive to your pain and struggles, or pop out to the store to pick up some formula, and risk being told it undermines breastfeeding. There is a happy medium. Partners don't need to know how to solve breastfeeding problems. They just need to help you link up with the support and information you need. Sometimes it's the partner who makes the first call to a LLL leader, or finds the date and location of the meeting on the website, LLLI.org. Or maybe your partner searches through the folder you were given by the midwife or hospital nurse with contact information about breastfeeding clinics or lactation consultants and makes an appointment for you. Partners want to connect with their babies too, and when they see the closeness and intimacy of the breastfeeding relationship, feeding the baby themselves looks like the obvious way to do it. But there are a gazillion ways to bond with a baby without bottle feeding. In fact, partners have the key role of teaching the baby that love sometimes comes without food. Some partners take over bath time. Your partner might like to let the baby have daily tummy time by leaning back on the couch, baby on chest, or by wearing the baby in a wrap or sling. Tummy time doesn't have to be horizontal. Partners can be wonderful comforters. Babies like different voices, from low and rumbly to soft and motherly. Most partners soon figure out their own repertoire of baby-soothing tricks. They will be different from the birth mothers, but different can help. Partners can often help by doing everything but feeding. They can take charge of diaper changes, most babies' favorite non-nursing activity after the early weeks, bring you a drink or snack, or both, and take the baby off for a relaxing walk or in-arms snooze when the feeding ends. Nursing itself isn't especially tiring. After the first few days or weeks, the baby can usually latch just fine, even if you're half asleep. So this kind of everything else help can make a huge difference, with no need to involve bottles. Why not just give a few bottles? Some babies seem to be able to adapt easily to the different kind of sucking involved. But even with these babies, mothers often find that they end up with feeding problems over time if there are too many bottles. The baby can learn to like the fast, steady flow from the bottle and get frustrated at the breast because the milk flows more slowly at first. There's also an effect on your milk production. If the baby is getting bottles, and you don't pump or express your milk, your breasts will make less milk. One of the most helpful things a partner can do is to be a buffer between you and other relatives and friends who may be uninformed or even opposed to breastfeeding. If your mother or mother-in-law didn't breastfeed, or tried to breastfeed for a short time but ended up weaning early, she might feel that your decision to nurse your baby is a subtle way of criticizing her choices and decisions. If breastfeeding was difficult for her, she may want to protect you from the pain and struggle she went through. Or she may feel that a longer breastfeeding relationship than hers is not only long, but wrong. Don't have a partner at all? That's a tougher road, for sure. But many, many single mothers have successfully breastfed and built their own unique community of support. There are sources of paid support, such as doulas and nannies, but there are no-cost possibilities, too. Enlisting friends to help with meals, entertaining your older children, and conversation when you need it. You may have friends or family eager to help out who just need some suggestions on what to do. If you don't have an already built support network, you can begin building one today, whether or not your baby is here. You can ask your caregiver about support groups available in your community. Ask at your LLL meeting if anyone would like to get together informally, or check with local religious and community centers to see if they offer groups for new parents. You may have heard it takes a village to raise a child. That can be interpreted to mean that the other villagers play a direct role in teaching and encouraging the child. But there's another way to look at it. The role of the village can be to support the new mother and her family, so that she can put her time and energy into mothering her baby and the child that her baby becomes. 10 ways a partner can help. 1. Before the baby's born, help stock the freezer with meals that can be eaten with one hand. 2. Find a good phone number for help and call it as needed. La Leche League's website, LLLI.org, and U.S.-based phone line, 877-4-LA-LECHE, 877-452-5324, can both lead you to your closest local group, and that's a fast route to anything else you might need. 3. Buy the grocery basics and keep easy, healthy snacks on hand. 4. Get dinner. Any dinner. 5. Nights can be tough at first. Be flexible about where and when everyone sleeps. Going to bed early helps. 6. Do more than your share. You may be what keeps the household running for a while. 7. Everything won't get done. Talk about what's most important to her, a clean kitchen, a clear desk, and do that first. 8. Get home on time. You're like a breath of fresh air for mother and baby both. 9. Helping out means helping emotionally, too. Remind her how much you love her, how wonderful she looks, and what a great job she's doing. There she is, holding your child. She really is beautiful, isn't she? 10. Remind her that this part is temporary. Most women feel it takes at least 6 weeks to start to have a handle on this motherhood thing. Life will settle down, but it takes a while. Online support. In the villages and networks we've been talking about, new parents get face-to-face support. Someone to demonstrate when you want to see how to hand express a little milk, someone to wash the dishes, and someone to give you a hug when it's been a long day. But many mothers today find they get an important layer of support from email, texting, instant messaging, or online forums. Where do you find this kind of network? Your local LLL group may offer an email list that you can join, or your prenatal class may create one that allows you to stay connected after your babies are born. You may find it especially helpful to communicate electronically with people you can also get together with in person. Or you might be able to connect with mothers around the world. Many websites, such as LLLI.org, offer forums where mothers ask and respond to questions. Some are more active than others, and some are more breastfeeding friendly than others. So pick carefully and be aware of the limits to internet support. A few people take advantage of the anonymity that email and forum usernames provide to post flames. Unkind, rude, and insulting messages that no new mother needs. You also don't know whether a website or poster's qualifications are valid. So weigh any information gathered this way against what you get from known, reliable sources. Those limitations aside, though, forums and email lists can be a great way to connect with other mothers. Sometimes it's easier to tell strangers about your struggles with thrush or the hurtful comment your mother-in-law made. If you have an unusual challenge, maybe you've given birth to triplets, or your baby has an uncommon problem, for example, you may be able to find a list for that specific issue. A huge help for those days when you're feeling alone in the world. And what faster way to connect with other wakeful friends at 2 a.m? Paid and professional support. After Lorna's baby, Morgan, was born, her mother came to stay with her for 6 weeks to look after the older children, take care of the house, and prepare all the meals, including stocking up Lorna's freezer with extra food she could pull out for weeks to come. Sadly, the techniques for cloning Lorna's mom haven't been perfected. If it fits into your budget, though, you can hire support. Postpartum doulas, for example, are available in many communities. They will come into your home for several hours a day, depending on your situation and needs, to help with housework and basic baby care, other than feeding the baby, of course. Many have some experience in helping breastfeeding mothers. You can also hire a nanny, cleaning service, personal chef, and so on, if your budget will stretch this far. One mother of breastfeeding twins hired a personal chef who came to her house, discussed the foods she liked and didn't like, then spent another day in her kitchen preparing, packaging, and freezing meals she could thaw and eat over the next month or so. Money well spent, she felt, and certainly less expensive than eating out in restaurants or buying formula for two babies. 10 things not to say to a new breastfeeding mother. 1. Is he eating again? 2. He's just using you for a pacifier. 3. Here, I'll feed the baby a bottle and you can go get some housework done. 4. Maybe your milk isn't good enough. 5. We've never made enough milk in our family. 6. Can breasts that size really make enough milk? 7. If you're going back to work, shouldn't he get used to having some of his feedings from other people? 8. You look like a cow attached to that pump.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.